The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much for joining us for a webinar hosted by the National Institute on Retirement Security with the National Academy of Social Insurance for this webinar, Social Insurance, Its History and Enduring Relevance. Just a few words of logistics for today's session. We have all of our attendees in listen-only mode, but that's only to block out any background noise. We do encourage your questions. Throughout the session, if you have any questions, feel free to type those into the question function on your control panel, and we'll answer them after the presentation. If you have any audio or technical issues during the webinar, please call GoToWebinar at 1-800-263-6317, and they should be able to help you out. We are recording this session, and later today we'll have a replay of the session as well as this PowerPoint presentation posted on our website. You can find it on nursonline.org/events. We have four speakers on today's webinar. The first is Dan Doonan. He's Executive Director of the National Institute on Retirement Security. Tyler Bond, Research Manager for the National Institute on Retirement Security. Also with us on the call today is Bill Arnone. He's the Chief Executive Officer of NASI, as well as Elaine Weiss, Lead Policy Analyst with the National Academy of Social Insurance. And with that, I'll turn the presentation over to Dan for some opening remarks. Dan?
Okay, thank you, Kelly. And thanks, Bill and Elaine, for joining us today. I wanted to start by noting that it's been an honor for Tyler and I becoming Academy members recently. And I also wanted to thank you, as the Academy has been a great partner organization through the past year for us, helping us connect with various experts. And if you don't read our noteworthy newsletter, we currently have an intern from the Academy. Izzy has been great. We gave her a challenging project to work on, but she's doing excellent work. So a big thanks for that relationship. So we've been doing a lot of webinars since the shutdown, and many have focused on the investment markets and that side of retirement, as it is a key factor for retirement, both for pension funds and individuals. But it's nice to have a chance to step back today and take a look at how our social insurance infrastructure has served Americans through this unique crisis. We know the jobs impact has caused massive increase in joblessness with a historic number of new unemployment claims. So we appreciate the chance to hear from both of you and to discuss these issues with our community today. Our rough outline for this session is to do about 20 minutes of presentation with Bill and Elaine, and then we'll do a brief conversation with Tyler and I, and then we'll leave plenty of time for Q&A for everyone participating. And I should mention that you don't have to wait until the third section to submit questions. We will get them and hold on to them for the end. So you can put in questions as we proceed through and as things cross your mind. And with that, I'm happy to hand things over to Elaine.
Thank you so much, Dan, Tyler, and Kelly for inviting us today and for all your work on this. The feeling is mutual. It is great to be here collaborating with NERS on this important and really, really timely webinar. As you highlighted, the work of our two organizations is very complementary. And today, we're really looking forward to a conversation that illuminates how social insurance programs can help reduce the impact of this pandemic, which is awful, and hopefully speed the recovery from it, which is something that we all really need to find ways to do. First slide, thanks. So social insurance, as I think you all in the audience are aware today, is much more than insurance in the normal sense of the word. The way we think about it at the Academy is more of a social contract that we all participate in as a society, and that provides protection against common life risks, but particularly life risks that are very hard or impossible to insure against privately. The COVID pandemic, of course, has presented a very broad range of these risks. Important among them are widespread and very sudden loss of employment and associated loss of income, sometimes completely. Loss of health insurance, because for many people in this country, that health insurance is tied to their job. sickness and hospitalization and the high cost associated with that. And very sadly and tragically, the death of a breadwinner, which has not been uncommon in the past few months. Given these high risks, social insurance programs are particularly critical at a time like this. And indeed, social insurance programs have been key to supporting families during COVID. As Dan noted, NERC has done fantastic work on various aspects of retirement security, and that work is even more important now as people are prematurely being pushed into retirement in very large numbers. Beyond that, the full range of social insurance programs have been working to protect and cushion individuals and families during this time. In some cases, normal life risks, as I said, job loss, sickness, and death, have been greatly amplified. This has illuminated the importance of these programs to society's capacity to function. In several cases of programs, unemployment insurance, workers' comp, Medicaid, and paid leave, Congress and our states have taken action to expand or adapt social insurance programs to better support people during the pandemic because this crisis is so unique. Before we delve into the conversation that we're looking forward to with Dan and Tyler and with all of you, Bill and I want to briefly describe the central role that a few social insurance programs have played in the past few months, but also to emphasize what more we feel is needed in order for them to fulfill their intended roles. And I thought that we should start today with unemployment insurance. Just because there's been, obviously, it's been headlines. And I guess I should start by saying, I never thought unemployment insurance would constantly be a headline in key papers, but it's good to see it getting the attention that it deserves. So unemployment insurance is designed to do really two complementary things. It's to protect individual workers who become jobless and their families due to no fault of their own, and also to act as a counter to downturns, to economic trends, especially in periods when unemployment is on the rise. As such, it doesn't just support individuals and their families by making up their lost income, but it serves to boost the economy and the nation as a whole by injecting some of that money back into that economy. It's especially critical for this reason in major recessions. We saw this in the Great Recession of 2007-2008, and we're seeing it now. Indeed, in major downturns, UI is often extended to provide benefits beyond the normal 26-week or 6-month maximum duration due to recognition that it's much harder for jobless people to find a new job in economies like this. In this case, Congress has gone even further. Because this downturn early on was predicted to be both so severe and so long-lasting, Congress authorized supplemental emergency benefits under the CARES Act. These extend UI to types of workers who normally do not qualify and did not qualify during the last recession, like independent contractors and gig workers. It also provides an additional $600 a week on top of the normal UI benefits that a jobless worker would receive. This UI relief under the CARES Act has been a lifesaver for millions of workers and their family members. It has reduced hunger, homelessness, and eviction, which have been critical during this period. But as we will talk about shortly, it's slated to shut in a few days, which is a huge problem. Another social insurance program that has gotten a tremendous amount of attention and that I am particularly gratified about, since I am one of a relatively few number of people who works intensively in this area, of course, is workers' compensation. For those of you who don't know, workers' compensation was the first social insurance program to be enacted in the U.S. It's the only one of the programs managed entirely at the state level. There's no federal mandate or oversight, which has its own issues. It was adopted by most states between 1910 and about 1920 or 25. Workers' comp provides both medical care and cash support for workers who are injured or become ill on the job. And in exchange for those benefits, workers waive the right to sue their employer. It also should be noted that it provides cash benefits to survivors, family members of workers who die due to work-related injuries. All of these benefits are particularly relevant right now. The high risks that face so-called frontline and essential workers in particular make these kinds of protections particularly important during this pandemic. And indeed, many of you have probably heard state policymakers and business owners pointing to these protections when they argue that workers don't need any further protection than the ones they already have. Unfortunately, as we discussed in some detail in a fact sheet that we recently published on the subject, workers' comp has actually never provided anything like the coverage of illnesses or occupational diseases as it does for injuries. Ironically, a major challenge to receive benefits for an occupational disease is when you need to prove that that disease was contracted as a result of the job, which is exactly the kind of burden of proof that workers' comp is supposed to deliver with and largely has in the context of injuries. Now, states have recognized this problem. About a third of states in Puerto Rico have adopted what are called presumptions, legal changes that assume that a worker in certain frontline or essential job categories who contract COVID did so at work. So in those states, those workers will have an easier time getting the coverage and compensation due to illness. But as we'll get to talk about later, even some of those workers face challenges. Others virtually are cut off their workers' comp, and the majority of states have not adopted such presumptions. So in fact, workers' comp provides much less protection in this context than most people probably believe it does. Let me turn that over, speaking of health, to Bill, to continue to talk about social insurance and healthcare.
Well, thank you, Elaine. And I'm gonna cover some of the healthcare related aspects of COVID in the social insurance space, starting with Medicare. Medicare, enacted in 1965, is now providing coverage for about 60 million beneficiaries. The bulk of them, over 51 million, are ages 65 and older, but almost 9 million are persons with disabilities who are under that age. And we have on our website an access to care brief, which just came out last week, that provides some highlights on the Medicare program and what its role is and how it is affected by the pandemic. As you can imagine, just from reading the news stories, older individuals have been disproportionately affected by COVID-19, as have people with disabilities. They're getting infected at higher rates, hospitalized at higher rates, and they are dying at higher rates. So for them, this is truly a catastrophic pandemic. Congress has passed legislation, including the CARES Act, which includes various provisions that would increase the availability of telehealth and home health services for Medicare beneficiaries. However, there are significant gaps and barriers in access to telehealth services due largely to the lack of access to technology, older people who are not quite as digitally literate as younger people, and just having reliable internet coverage. Now, the Medicare program itself has stated it will provide testing services without any cost sharing to the beneficiary. Some of those are being provided today as more testing services get expanded. And by the way, we need more and different testing services. The current class of testing services are time consuming, labor intensive, and slow. And as you've known, probably from hearing all of the discussions about the next wave, we are so far behind in testing, we've got to ramp it up, and that will mean additional costs for Medicare. Treatment itself, beyond vaccines and testing, treatment, everything we're hearing, it will be extremely costly, especially for beneficiaries in traditional Medicare Part B who don't have supplemental coverage and have no out-of-pocket limits. So their exposure to the increased Medicare costs from COVID-19 could be significant. And that's something that legislation would need to address. Next item is Medicaid. Now, traditionally, Medicaid may not be thought of as a social insurance program because it has one feature that social insurance programs typically don't have, and that is a means test. It's fair to say, I think, however, that as a result of the Affordable Care Act, Medicaid's population has grown to exceed that of Medicare. Currently, over 70 million Americans are on Medicaid, many of them newly eligible due to the Affordable Care Act's expansion. We also cover Medicaid in our Access to Care brief. And here again, you can imagine with the devastating economic consequences of COVID, more and more people will be able to meet Medicare's income thresholds. As a result of that, what do we know? We know Medicaid program costs will increase. There'll be higher enrollment from people who are losing their employer-covered plans and from the high cost of COVID-19 treatment. And I know many of you on this webinar represent state governments. I dare say your governor, if he or she were asked, what is the biggest threat to our financial sustainability, they probably would list Medicaid as one of those biggest threats. Expenses out of control and drains on state resources. When you combine Medicaid with the Children's Health Insurance Program, CHIP, both of those are now required to cover COVID-19 related testing with no cost sharing and, believe it or not, no utilization management. So state Medicaid programs have an additional burden. Now they are getting some help. They are eligible to receive a 6.2 percentage point increase in their federal medical assistance percentage share from the federal government. Congress has also allocated about $150 billion in an emergency fund for states and local governments. All the feedback we're getting is not enough. States can cover testing for the uninsured in order to get a 100% federal match for the duration of the public health emergency period, subject, of course, to more congressional action. Expansion of funding is temporary and the clock is ticking. I think it's fair to say that without some additional federal legislation, state Medicaid programs will be in further trouble financially. And many of them will need to create, as I'm sure all of you on this call who work for state governments know, most states are under balanced budget constitutional requirements and their fiscal years may have started already. They've got to balance budgets, which usually will mean Medicaid spending reductions. And then it's a spiraling effect. Those cuts will further decrease access to care for the most vulnerable groups in our country, especially during a health and economic crisis. So Medicaid clearly is in the spotlight in terms of what it needs to do and how it is affected by this crisis. In short, when you look at social insurance overall, the social insurance infrastructure, and its related programs like Medicaid, the weaknesses and the gaps just jump out at you. As you heard from Elaine, what's not working well? Unemployment insurance benefits are clearly insufficient, although the recent boost of $600 a week has helped millions, but the unemployment benefit infrastructures are clearly inadequate, and unemployment insurance duration in most states is still too short. We're getting horror stories from people on the front lines of state systems where applicants cannot navigate these outdated systems. They feel overwhelmed, and what do they end up doing? They give up. So that's why the actual recipient rate in many states is below 50%, because people who are eligible give up. They can't handle the process. So the current unemployment insurance system is failing. As Lane said, workers' compensation still not well suited to handle disease like COVID. Some states are taking the lead to be more flexible, but clearly they're not getting the job done overall when you look at the country as a whole. And as I just said, insufficient Medicaid funding. There are other gaps. Paid leave. We've done a whole report on universal family care, which is available on our website. Paid leave is still something that the CARES Act is encouraged on a limited basis, but millions of American workers and their families are left out. Childcare is logistically difficult now, financially out of reach for most. Add to that the uncertainty with the school year that's coming up. It just compounds the childcare problems affecting millions of Americans. Long-term care, I'm sure all of you have read, once again, the horror stories of how COVID has declared war, in particular, on residents of long-term care facilities, skilled nursing facilities, custodial arrangements. They are bearing a heavy brunt of the devastating consequences of this awful virus. And then is this notion of assured income, which is something the Academy is devoting attention to as a new policy concept. And the basic essence behind it is when you look at social insurance programs like Social Security, when you look at social assistance programs like public assistance, TANF, supplemental security income, and you look at tax policy and you add them together, people still fall through the cracks. And the cracks mean they're living lives of economic destitution. How can our country look at that infrastructure, make it work better on an integrated basis, and then for those gaps, develop some level of assured income that pretty much says to any person who's a citizen of this country, there's a floor below which you shall not fall. And that's really the essence of assured income that we're looking at. We're doing that through an economic security study panel that is deliberating this year, and will be issuing its report at the end of this year or early next year. It's coinciding with the Roosevelt 1935 Committee on Economic Security, which issued the landmark report that led to Social Security and unemployment insurance in our country. If you want to know more about all the resources we are devoting to COVID-19, please go to our website. There's a COVID-19 social insurance response section, and we keep that up to date. I welcome all of you, Dan, Tyler, members of your institute. If you come across good resources, some of them you may have authored yourselves, bring them to our attention. This is not just produced by the Academy. We're trying to make it as robust as possible and look at all sources of credible evidence-based research and reports. Kelly, back to you.
Great. Do you want to go with the polls now or turn it back over to Dan?
Yeah, I think we have a couple of polling questions. Elaine, you want to do the first one on unemployment insurance? I think that's the first on our list.
Oh, no, go for it. You're Mr. Pollster, Bill.
Great. So for all of the participants, we're going to have a couple poll questions. If you just take a few minutes and a few seconds and give us your responses, you should see a poll question up on your screen. What should Congress do about the CARES Act $600 UI supplement that expires on July 31st? So there's a couple options and you can select one. And we'll keep that open for just a couple seconds and then we'll show you the results. All right, hopefully that was enough time for everyone to program in their answer. So I'm going to close out the poll and show the results. So hopefully everyone can see the results there. Can you see the results, Bill?
Yes.
Great. Okay. I'll turn it over to you to comment on that.
Elaine, you have some initial observations on the results?
So it looks like we are, so first of all, nobody really wants to let it expire, which is good to know, but it sounds like, it looks like we're about evenly divided between extending it for either a limited time or indefinitely, and I think it's probably hard to figure out which of those makes the most sense right now, given we really don't have a good sense of what's going to go on with COVID, how long it's going to go on, and how bad it will be. And nearly another half of people feel we should revise and reauthorize it. I assume that one possibility is in response to concerns that maybe the amount right now, there are some concerns among governors and others that $600 is high enough to potentially disincentivize folks from going back to work. But there for sure could be other reasons as well.
Great. Okay, so you want to move on to the second poll question, Bill?
I believe this would be a good time to do that.
Okay. Let me show that one. Okay, so here's our second poll question for those of you who are on the webinar. On the
Academy, just elaborate a little bit. As I mentioned, we have an economic security study panel that's exploring this. And a short income, just to give it a simple definition, in some publications that are widespread, it's referred to as universal basic income. We're looking at it a little bit differently. Universal basic income has a whole body of literature with it. We don't say that assured income has to include all of these provisions. Essentially, though, it's the idea that no one should have a monthly income from all sources below a certain level. An example of an assured income policy that might help when you're answering this question, Social Security used to have baked in a minimum benefit. So let's say your Social Security earnings record and your years of service through the benefits formula resulted in a very low monthly benefit. Social Security would raise that to a minimum regardless of your past contributions. That has withered away. So in effect, it no longer exists. That would be an example of a short income that would be baked into a program like Social Security. So I hope that illustration helps in your deciding whether support these. I guess there really isn't a question here, but it's do you support the idea of a short income? Do you oppose it or are you not sure?
And let me just read the question one more time because it looks like it might have got cut off in the poll. The Academy's Economic Study Security Study Policy is exploring the addition of an assured income provision to bolster current social insurance programs. Should this be part of the U.S. economic security policy? Yes, no, or not sure? I'll leave that open for just another couple seconds. And let's see the results we've got up here. And there's the results. You can see those, Joe?
Yes, and I must say, if you had asked me to bet on the results, I would not have thought it would be this high. This is very revealing. I hope during the Q&A period they will be able to elaborate more on their support of it. Of course, those who oppose, I would have expected a higher degree of not sure because it's a new concept. So I must say 56% is very surprising.
Great. And do you want to do the third question now too?
Dan and Tyler have a couple of other questions before we get to the third.
Okay, great. We'll turn it over to Dan and Tyler now.
All right. Well, thank you, Bill and Elaine, for that excellent presentation. So one thing, you know, social insurance programs kind of function in a couple of different ways. And these programs sometimes provide a pillar of support to all Americans, like Social Security does, while other programs are really important when families have unexpected events, such as losing their job. So can you tell us what you think are some important takeaways about these programs, especially considering how quickly and how hard the current pandemic and recession hit the United States?
So I'm going to start with one observation, and that is I think this pandemic crystallizes something that's been a growing reality for a while. And that is, I think that there's not as big a distinction as perhaps there was in the past between support for things that we should expect to hit all of us and things that are unexpected. I remember when the floods, the hurricanes hit Houston, sitting around our office and saying, you know, this is the kind of catastrophic event that we all were saying is once in a century, and it's clearly not once in a century. And it's also not clear that it's the kind of catastrophe that we can deal with private insurance. And it really got us thinking, talking more about the need to possibly think differently about social insurance. In that context, it was because the environment, because of climate change, was really forcing us to think differently. For sure, there are connections between the natural environment and this pandemic, and it's a different kind of natural disaster. But I think, again, it really highlights the reality that things we used to validly call unexpected really aren't that unexpected anymore. And that really, I think, forces us to think more broadly about what social insurance should be protecting us from.
That's good. Bill, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, I think this might be a good time to raise something the Academy is exploring that addresses a part of the question being asked, and that would then open up for our third polling question. One of the things that we are looking at is the impact that the pandemic might have on different social insurance programs, like the ones we've talked about, Social Security, Medicare, workers' comp, and unemployment insurance. And we haven't formed it yet, but we're in the process of putting together a COVID-19 task force. It'll be made up primarily of epidemiologists and healthcare policy experts, both who are members of the Academy and others who've been in the news who are not members of the Academy. And one of the things this task force will work on during the remainder of this year is taking a deep dive into the epidemiological data and creating three scenarios, perhaps more, but three scenarios that would then be examined in depth as to their likelihood of occurring. And most importantly, feed the data to the Social Security and Medicare trustees and actuaries. For those of you who read the most recent trustees reports, both of them issued disclaimers right at the start. We did not take into account any aspect of COVID-19. I remember when I read it in April, COVID had just broken, and I'm thinking, well, this report will have a short shelf life. This changes everything. So what this task force will do is it'll develop three or more scenarios. I'm going to ask Kelly to put up the question we're going to ask you, and let me describe each of the scenarios before you vote so that you have a better sense of what you're voting on. So, Kelly, can you get those scenarios up?
Yep.
Okay, so we have optimistic, intermediate, and pessimistic. With the optimistic scenario, it's based on the following: that COVID-19 is a one-time occurrence, B, it will weaken as it mutates, C, an effective treatment for it will be developed and made available this year, and D, individuals will become immune from getting it again and from passing it on. That's the optimistic scenario. Let me jump to the pessimistic scenario, and then we'll do the intermediate. The pessimistic scenario, and all I can say is we are in deep trouble if this turns out to be reality. Everything goes wrong. A, COVID is with us for the rest of our lives, if you can imagine that, just like the flu. B, unlike the flu, although the flu varies, COVID will strengthen as it mutates. That will make it an extraordinarily unique virus. C, no vaccination, no treatment will be available in 2020 or even in 2021. And D, there is no immunity. Imagine any one of those four variables would be difficult to handle, but just fathom the thought of all four coming together. And then the intermediate scenario would be something in the middle of each of the four variables. So for example, COVID will be temporarily recurring. It's not an annual permanent situation. B, it will simply maintain its strength as it mutates, will not weaken or strengthen. C, vaccinations and treatments will be developed in 2020 and made available in 2021. And D, there's some level of immunity, although it's not clear what that level will be. So to put you all on the spot, which of these three scenarios do you think is most likely? So, I'm hoping the actuaries in the audience would relish this question, or who knows?
Great. So we'll give everyone just a couple more seconds to select your answer, and then we will close out the poll and display the results.
Anybody want to bet?
Well, I can see the answers as they're coming in, so I won't bet. But
okay. Ed, what do you think your audience is going to say?
I think people like choosing the one in the middle.
To play it safe, huh?
Well, there you go.
That's a good guess. Let me close up the poll and show the results.
Oh, no. Well, we can only hope that it's not the last one, although one out of five of you thinks it is. I will tell you, and it's been difficult. I've been immersing myself in this over the past couple of months, not an epidemiologist myself, but getting immersed in the data. And if I had to say today what's most likely, unfortunately, I would say pessimistic as well. And every day it seems to get more pessimistic. I just heard a Rockefeller Foundation webinar this morning that the testing we're now talking about is just inadequate to enable us to really identify people who are most susceptible at transmission. And if you think about that, even though we say testing, 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 if the current testing isn't quite up to what we need, and it's not just in numbers, it's quality as well. It's accessibility, it's affordability, it's convenience, it's fast response. Just imagine what that means going forward. So I hope none of you signed up for this webinar to feel good, because the prospects are not very good.
So I'm going to change gears here a little bit. And I did want to ask you, in past webinars, we've heard about the lack of policymaking flexibility that stemmed from years and years of underinvestment in state unemployment technology systems. And I believe that's how we got to a flat $600 increase in unemployment, was a lot of the state systems couldn't do other ideas that were proposed. Are there any other lessons to be learned from the current crisis about these programs?
Well, let me take a first shot at it, and then Elaine, please supplement it. I mentioned earlier the whole area of childcare. To me, that one is just really leaping out at us, combining the lack of paid family leave with the big question mark about the return to school, especially for the youngest children in our country. We are the only developed country in the world that doesn't have a universally available childcare program, which means that for most people, it's extraordinarily expensive and something has to give. Either they can't continue to work because of the burdens of childcare, they have to reduce their hours and reduce their income. It's just a cascading effect. And what COVID has illuminated for us is the need to revisit and re-energize the whole discussion around what we like to call universal family care, of which child care is one element. You may have noticed yesterday, presidential candidate Biden came out with a very extensive child care plan. We'll be issuing an analysis of it before the week is over. It does need to be part of the presidential conversation, and it's something that I think this whole crisis just again illustrates how we must have policy making, not just flexibility, but policy making innovation and a little bit of boldness in order to meet the very real needs that people are experiencing in our country.
Fully, fully agreed. And speaking of underinvestment and lack of boldness, I don't know how many people have been paying attention to this part, but another place where we've seen massive underinvestment is OSHA, which really, unfortunately, compounds the weaknesses that we're seeing in the workers' comp program. So in addition to workers' comp, or on top of workers' comp, really not being well designed to protect workers in a context where we've got a virus that's very widespread and very contagious, and it's pretty hard to know where you did or didn't get it, with few exceptions, we have an agency that has been just chopped up in recent decades, defamed. There's just simply not enough inspectors to keep workplaces safe, even in normal times. And these are, of course, extraordinary times. And then on top of that, OSHA seems to be hamstrung right now. So one statistic we saw that was just so stark and upsetting to me was OSHA's had, as of a month ago, I believe, well over 5,000 complaints about unsafe workplaces. And we think about meatpacking plants, we think about Amazon warehouses, on and on and on. And there's no complaints basically being filed. It's a really, really big problem. So it also showcases, you know, programs don't implement themselves. And if we don't have the agencies available to enforce rules, then, you know, programs are really weaker.
Yeah, those are both great thoughts. And I sympathize personally with the lack of childcare as a we are parents who are trying to manage overseeing schooling while we're working, and we just learned that schools are not opening where we are. So I think Tyler's got the next question.
Yeah, thanks, Dan. So in one of the most recent reports that NERS released, we found that women have lower retirement income than men, and that there's a lot of structural reasons for this outcome. And over the course of the last few months with the pandemic and the recession, there have been a lot of stories in the news predicting that women will fall behind economically as a result of the recession, especially as was just alluded to, with so many childcare options closed and school reopening very much in doubt for this fall. So Bill and Lane, what can you all say about how these various social insurance programs are supporting women during the current crisis?
So both programs that I've been looking at are critical really to women, the two that I'm talking about. All the reasons that inside women are falling behind, and one big problem is going into this substantially less than men, but also employed in occupations that have been the hardest hit, like hospitality. So they lost jobs at disproportionate numbers. And they also were already making low wages. So for all these reasons, on the one hand, programs like UI are especially important to women, and at the same time, weaknesses in those programs, lack of access to them, categories of workers who are not eligible for UI, difficulty getting in, trouble navigating the system, disproportionately hurt women for all those reasons. And feeding back to the research you guys are doing, all of that means that women are going to be even less prepared for retirement because they can't make the wages they need to accumulate assets now or to pay into Social Security the way they need to. Similarly, on the workers' comp front, women are disproportionately in the frontline and essential jobs that are getting hit the hardest by COVID and that lack those protections. So we're seeing both this sort of double-edged sword that social insurance programs are critically important to women, and yet the weaknesses and gaps in those programs are hitting women very hard. And all of that is going to compound their lack of readiness for a secure retirement. Again, going right back to where you guys are with the research on that.
And Elaine, if I could just add one other aspect of this, when you look at women overall, as Elaine says, they're already falling further behind. But when you zero in and look at women of color, particularly Black and Latina women, they are suffering disproportionately due to all of the impacts of COVID. And that's nothing new. Even today, with the current set of programs we have, the highest poverty rates in our country are women of color, particularly women who are not married. This is a problem we have had for a long time. And again, the question is, will COVID finally push us to adopt meaningful responses to the disproportionate level of devastation and income pain that women of color are suffering in our country?
Okay, thanks for that. Before we get to questions, I had questions from the audience. I had one more that I did want to ask. What do you see as major gaps in our social insurance systems that have been exposed by this crisis? If there's one big fix you could make, you know, what would that look like?
Dan, that does go to the heart of the economics study panel that we talked about and the concept of a short income. So I do think that's rising to the level of not only desirability, but feasibility. I think the Economic Security Study Panel will document the case to be made for at least the options to be looked at. We do not make recommendations as an academy. We lay out options. We analyze their trade-offs. But they then provide evidence for policymakers to say, you know what? There's enough evidence to show that this is something that's doable. So to me, that would be the big takeaway would be this concept of assured income.
Good. Do you want me to move on to audience questions, Dan?
Yeah, let's get to audience questions.
Okay. The first one I'll go ahead and take. Will there be a recording available of this session? Yes, we'll have that posted on the NERS website later today, www.nersonline.org/events, and you can find the recording and these PowerPoint slides. The next question, can you speak to the pandemic situation of unemployment insurance being primarily used to pay rental expenses and thus being funneled into a sector of the economy that doesn't necessarily need stimulus as much as spending? Anyone want to take on?
I'm a tiny bit unclear about the question. Unemployment insurance by its nature is about making up for lost wages. So that is sort of the definition of the program itself. I'm wondering if the questioner is actually asking about maybe like paycheck protection program or so. I'm a little bit unsure. Dan, Tyler, Bill?
Yeah, I'm not exactly clear either. I know there was a time period where evictions would be prevented, but that doesn't mean that people don't have to pay their rent and there eventually won't be consequences. So I do think some of the UI money is definitely going to pay rent and to keep people in their housing. As far as spending on different aspects, different parts of the economy, I don't know that we have anything that on that front, really.
Oh, thank you. The next question, how worried are we about the long-term impact of COVID on Medicare's finances, and what are potential solutions, if so?
Yeah, I'd be open to take a first shot at that. The answer is very worried. As I said, the COVID-19 task force will look at what these scenarios could mean for Medicare, and just imagine what it might mean. First of all, the Medicare program itself, its trust fund is in much more precarious shape than the Social Security trust fund. So we already know before COVID something had to give. And the question is, what is it? How do we put further restraints on cost increases when COVID is causing hospitals and primary care physicians to possibly shut down? What are you going to do about the remaining supply? How that's going to be affected with its price? What will that do to Medicare's annual costs? In terms of people being unemployed, Medicare, as with Social Security, lives on contributions from current workers. What's going to happen with the revenue stream for Medicare? You can just go on and see it's a compounded effect on both the revenues that Medicare is losing and the additional costs that Medicare will bear. So the prospects can be quite dire.
Thank you. Our next question, is there legislation regarding Social Security in Congress now that you see as either good for the program or a source of concern that's damaging to the program?
Well, I'll take that again. There is legislation in the House. Congressman Larson, at the Ways and Means Committee, he chairs the Social Security Subcommittee, he has consistently proposed his plan to correct Social Security's long-term financing for the next 75 years. That's the time horizon that Social Security's actuaries use. Senator Congressman Larson goes about this without any benefit reductions. He solves Social Security's financing strictly through revenue increases. One of the major ones was the raising of the wage base on which Social Security contributions are made each year. He doesn't eliminate the wage base right away. He kind of phases it out. And that raises up a lot of revenue, but not enough. But he has proposed consistently what I would call the most expansive view of Social Security. He has, just to give you the political reality, he has not been able to get one Republican sponsor. In the House, you don't really need that. but in the Senate, there's no counterpart. So I would say between now and Election Day, the prospect of a meaningful Social Security reform package being enacted is pretty close to zero. What happens after January? It's a new ball game. I think you'll see Congress getting serious about Social Security. I think it's fair to say most people don't want a repeat of what we did in 1983. We waited till the 11th hour, and then we tried to cobble together an extreme package that probably left something for everyone to be unhappy about. I don't sense anybody wants to repeat that. I think while time is on the side of Congress, I expect there'll be some action 2021 or perhaps 2022.
And I'd like to add one thing. There is talk, I don't know if there's legislation, but there's talk about a payroll tax cut. That doesn't necessarily have to be bad for Social Security if the costs are absorbed with the general fund, but if it leads to a loss of revenue into Social Security, I think we would expect the time frame before Social Security doesn't have money to pay full benefits would be pulled forward. So I think that is talked about. It does strike me as something that would help people who have kept their jobs and possibly employers if they were given a payroll tax holiday. Whereas, you know, a lot of these other efforts, I think, are more aimed at people who weren't able to keep their jobs because of this crisis.
You know, I agree, Dan. You remember we did this some years ago under the Obama administration, a 2% temporary holiday. The reaction to that was it won't be temporary, it'll be permanent. Well, guess what? It was temporary. The 2% was restored and there wasn't an outcry. But I think the one that the president's talking about is not 2%, it's 6.2%. And the question is, if you let that go on holiday, does it turn into a permanent vacation and then what? So I think it's a very perplexing proposal.
Well, the next question is sort of related to that. Given the financial precariousness of Medicare after COVID, isn't the Trump payroll tax cut somewhat risky?
Well, my understanding is payroll cut will only be the Social Security portion of FICA. It won't be the Medicare 1.45%. But again, who knows? Once they start going down that path, I could see people saying, well, why stop at Social Security? Let's do it for Medicare as well. And then Medicare Part B, don't forget, that is heavily subsidized. 75% of premiums are paid for by general revenues, not by the premium. So that's a costly program to the overall federal treasury. So you've got to look at all of Medicare, not just the part financed by payroll contributions.
Our next question, can you please speak briefly on the overall impact of COVID on Social Security OASDI, especially SSDI?
Yeah, that's exactly what I mentioned with the COVID-19 task force will look at what these different scenarios mean to Social Security's old age, survivor, and disability benefit. That's the precise scope of the task force. And again, if the scenario is pessimistic, you can just imagine what that's going to do to not only the revenues that will be lost, but when benefits are based on earnings records and you then out of the workforce or taking a deep cut in earnings, your benefits reduced. With disability, as you probably know, for the past 2 years, we have seen a dramatic reduction in disability applications and disability awards. That could turn around dramatically in 1 year if one impact of COVID is it may not kill you, but boy, will you be disabled for a significant rest of time of your life. And we can only imagine what that would do to disability insurance applications. So again, the pessimistic scenario would be devastating for the Social Security old age survivor and disability insurance programs.
Great, thank you so much. I think that covers all the questions that we've received in. So thanks everyone for those insightful questions. I'll turn it over to Dan for one last question or comment and to close us out.
Sure. I'll make a quick comment. Not to minimize the importance of all the other programs that have been discussed today, but at NERS, we've been growing more and more focused on long-term care. For retirement, we know that about half of seniors won't need long-term care, but about 15% will need long-term care that's going to cost, over the time they use it, about $250,000. And as we've been moving away from income systems that have pooled investment risk, pooled longevity risk, and individuals are being asked to step up and figure out retirement on their own, we're seeing this as a really big barrier. So I did want to mention the program that was started in Washington State, where it seems like a couple major step forward that we've seen there. Washington State's implemented a long-term care program where they charge about 0.5% in a payroll tax. Everybody in the state that pays in for a certain period of time will be able to draw benefit, but it's capped at about $36,000. It seems to me like that takes a lot of the risk pooling, and you know, long-term care generally happens. It's a very difficult situation personally, but the financial side of it is really, really a big thing. And I know, Bill, you've worked on that and you're familiar with it, so I wanted to ask you about that before we go.
Yes, I'm glad you mentioned it. First of all, because there are so many state systems on this webinar, states really have a traditional role to play as laboratories of bold social programs that become nationalized. I think Elaine may have mentioned workers' comp started out in the state of Wisconsin before the federal government ever took a look at it as a national need. So the state of Washington is definitely the first out of the box. They are taking a true social insurance approach, payroll contributions to finance a benefit. They start collecting in 2022. The benefit goes into effect in 2025. So as with the U.S. Social Security program, there's early collection and delayed benefit. It'd be fascinating to see how it works, if it gets administered on time. It's a horrendous task, but the state seems to be going about it the right way. And we're in constant communication with Governor Inslee and his office to see how this goes. So all eyes will be in the state of Washington. I found something ironic the other day. I was on a phone call with the United Kingdom. They have a nationalized healthcare system. And guess what the biggest problem, the UK, not the biggest, one of the biggest problems is their system doesn't cover what they call social costs. That's their word for long-term service and supports. So even the most advanced socialized system of healthcare does not cover what we call the long-term service and supports. It's a gap all around the world. In this case, we're not alone. One of our Academy members, Ezekiel Emanuel, has a book that just came out, and he said the best long-term services and support program in the world can be found in the country of Germany. So as we did with Social Security, we're going to be looking at the German experience and probably look at some lessons learned from their experience.
That's great. And I just remember, Tyler has one more question for you before we wrap up here.
Yeah, Bill, I know the Academy right now is conducting the Robert Ball Award campaign for social insurance. And so I just wanted to ask you to tell us a little bit more about the campaign that you all are conducting.
Yes, every year the Academy recognizes the folks who've made a significant contribution to one or more areas of social insurance. This year we're honoring two people, Jacob Hacker at Yale and Virginia Reno, formerly with Social Security Administration and formerly with our Academy as our head of policy, income security policy. They've been gracious enough to say, you know, we're thrilled to be honored, but let's go bigger. Let's honor social insurance as a concept. So we rolled out a couple of weeks ago the beginning of a campaign honoring the two of them and social insurance. It's going to be a series of webinars that will have thought leaders talking about social insurance. And we are issuing, before this month is over, I hope, a compendium of reflections by the 14 living Ball Award recipients, people like Steve Goss, Bruce Vladeck, Marilyn Moon, and it's called The Future of Social Insurance, Reflections on the Pandemic. And I think that'll be a very compelling compendium on what we are learning about social insurance. And again, as the theme of this webinar, it's not just what social insurance has done, and we don't want to minimize what it's done. What has it not done that we must address with the risks that are now emerging? One of the contributors has identified the risk of bankruptcy. Why don't we have a social insurance program to address bankruptcy? So I think you'll find a very provocative collection, and it'll be part of an ongoing series throughout 2020 called the Ball Award Campaign for Social Insurance. So thank you, Tyler. And Tyler, you've been a key member of the leadership committee of that campaign, and thank you for everything you've done to help promote it.
And of course, I'm glad to be a part. And I'd just like to say that Jacob Hacker, one of this year's honorees, is also an academic advisory board member for NERS. So we're very pleased to see him honored with this prestigious award.
Yes, indeed. So I want to start off by thanks again to Bill and Elaine for spending your time sharing your thoughts with us today. I think it was really insightful. There's a lot of great information. So we really appreciate that. I appreciate everybody that jumped on the webinar with us today to hear about the program. And I hope everybody stays safe. And, you know, thank you again and goodbye.
Thanks, guys. Yeah.